Hi everybody, this is Levi Clay for Guitar Interactive magazine, and I'm sat here with one of my biggest influences, and I'm assuming for our readers one of your bigger influences, Mr. Robben Ford. Robben, how's it going?
Good, thanks Levi.
Pleasure to have you here. Thank you. And you're in London just for the one day, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Out on the promotional run.
Yeah, a little bit. I had a couple of shows in Germany in between. You know, Paris, Cologne for the record, then Germany, then here.
So we'll come on to the new record, but as this is the first time we've had you in the magazine, I figured we'd go back a little bit and you could talk to the readers a little bit about who you are and your background. So when did you pick up the guitar?
I think I was probably about 13 years old. My first instrument was the alto saxophone. And my father played the guitar, although it had been put away in the closet, quite frankly, and he hadn't touched it in years. And I've started to fool around on it, and he showed me my first few chords. Mm-hmm. And you know, by the time I was 15, I was playing with my older brother Patrick and his band, and we were basically playing rhythm and blues, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, even we were playing, you know, songs from Booker T and the MGs and Otis Redding and Wilson mm-hmm. Pickett and music like that, as well as the Butterfield Blues Band, which was my first real wake up to high energy electric guitar, Mike Bloomfield being the lead guitarist, and you know, he was my first, you know, real hero.
Yeah. And so was that purely self-taught? Was there mm-hmm. I mean, you mentioned the alto saxophone, which I think I can kind of hear in the playing, but was there education there and then no
that
education,
was simply, or? You know, school. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, no one really taught you anything exactly.
Yeah.
But I did learn how to read notes, and I learned how to read rhythms, mm-hmm. you know. But that didn't really transfer to the guitar,
you know.
I mean, I kind of sussed it out a little bit on the guitar. I can kind of read a little, but not really well or quickly at all.
Okay.
Chords and rhythms I can read, you know. I'm all right with that.
You've got, we were talking about one of my favourite tunes of yours, Riley B. King, just before we started, and as mm-hmm. you mentioned, there's quite a lot of chords in there, so you've mm-hmm. got a big chord palette. Has that been all experimentation then, or?
No, I did what I encourage everyone else to do. I got a book, you know.
Right, okay.
I bought a book, Mickey Baker, Jazz Chords, Volume 1.
Okay.
And I learned all the chords in that book, and he has, you know, methods of how to use them.
Right.
Which were, you know, very like, I mean, I learned how to play major seventh chords, for instance, which you're not going to find in the blues so much. But, you know, the chord progressions were very, you know, like standard traditional jazz, and really out of the 20s, 30s, 40s. So I, at the time, was playing with Charlie Musselwhite, the blues harmonica player, and so I was taking these chords and putting them into what I was doing with Charlie in a mm-hmm. Chicago blues setting, and totally, you know, fit, I mean, perfectly, because it's 2-5-1s, you know. It's just in the blues context, it's all there.
I remember Ian Scott, ex-resident of the Guitar Institute, reminding me that above the door as he walked in when he first went there, it said 2-5-1 is God, and mm-hmm. I kind of live by that still now.
So in the jazz tradition, that's it.
Okay, so first bands, it was with your brother, right? And then
brothers and I were playing together when we were still in school, and my older brother graduated, and when I finally graduated, I was able to join him in the Bay Area, which is what we call around San Francisco mm-hmm. Bay, and you know, we found some like-minded people, and actually, and you know, looked at an ad in a paper. There was a little blurb that said, "Blues harp player wants to get out of Sunnyvale," and Sunnyvale was one of the suburbs, you know. So we called him, and in fact, you know, we developed a very strong friendship and played a lot of music. His name was Gary Smith, and but eventually, when Mark, our younger brother, was, you know, got out of school. Mm-hmm. He joined us. The three of us had a band called the Charles Ford Band, which was we named after our father, Charles Ford.
Okay.
And we worked together like that for a while, you know. Patrick and I played with Charlie Musselwhite for about a year. And eventually he and I went separate ways, and I had the opportunity to work with Jimmy Witherspoon, the blues singer. Mm-hmm. And so I moved to Los Angeles and played with Jimmy Witherspoon for about 2 years. And then right at the end of that period of time was when I started getting called to do kind of bigger things, mm-hmm. you know.
Yeah, you've got some serious credits to your name, Joni Mitchell, Miles Davis. You're a seasoned player in that respect. But as your own artist, mm-hmm. You've got so many albums and so many great albums. And I think the beauty of being able to talk to you now, rather than, well, obviously it would be nice to have spoken to you back in the day, albums like Help the Poor being, you know, biggest influence
for
many
daughter.
People. Talk, sorry, of course.
That was the name of the album.
I'm thinking the tune.
Well, like, the song was kind of popular.
Yeah. Incredibly popular tune. I teach both Talk to Your Daughter and Help the Poor to every student. It's essential learning. The solo on Help the Poor, number one blues fusion solo you could ever possibly learn. So get on that one. Love the record. A revelation, of course.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful tune. But let's move on to now, the last sort of four albums.
Okay.
I saw you in a clinic, let's think, maybe 3 years ago, I think. 3 years ago, down in Guildford. And you were talking a lot about songwriting, more so than... More so than the guitar side of things. Mm-hmm. When did that become such a big deal to you? Because you've always been a songwriter, but on that clinic, I really got the impression that that's all you really cared about now, and it came through. So could you talk to us about that a bit?
Sure. As a musician, you have to make choices. This is something I think a lot of people don't quite understand, and especially, you know, back when the studio scene in Los Angeles really exploded, you know, and MI, Music Institute, you know, Guitar Institute of Technology opened and everything in LA. I think, people thought that you had to be able to play every style of music. And so if you go to a music school that, you know, you might be studying, you know, jazz, rock and roll, blues, country and western, mm-hmm. Et cetera, you know. And it just isn't like that, you know. There is no one on planet Earth who can play every style great.
Yeah.
You might think they can for a minute.
Sure.
But if you put that person, you know, next to somebody who specializes in that music, he's going to get his ass kicked, you know. So I specialized a long time ago, pretty much. I found myself in a variety of settings over the years, but... You know, my background is in blues, and then I taught myself what I could about jazz, you know, particularly harmony. I wanted to learn chords. So at a certain point, rather than, you know, like really work hard to develop myself as a guitar player per se, mm-hmm. I decided that it was important to me, first of all, to be playing my own music instead of covers, you know, and that's one of the things in the jazz world is you're playing standards, you know. That's the basis of it anyway. And I didn't want to do that, and I wanted to write my own music. That began as instrumental music. You know, I was writing songs that for me were kind of akin to what I was hearing from Wayne Shorter. And Blue Note Records was big for me. You know, I used to listen to a lot of Blue Note Records, you know, which would be Lee Morgan, Wayne Shorter, Herbie Hancock, you know, everybody, Joe Henderson. And all these guys were writers, but the songs were simple. Mm-hmm. And generally modal, you know, for the most part. So that fit for me, you know, not a lot of chords, a lot of it minor, you know. And so I ran with that. But once I started working with other artists, it opened my world up to, you know, not so much necessarily pop music, but, I mean, Joni Mitchell I would never consider pop.
Yeah.
Just broader scope, you know, and songs, you know, as opposed to improvising.
Sure. Music that the fans of music like listening to rather than just musicians.
Music that goes beyond just the musicians, musicians' music, yes.
Yeah.
So, as time went on, I came to just really appreciate a lyric and a story. So I decided that I wanted to focus on that. That's how I was going to grow as an artist, would be as a songwriter, you know, learning how to not only say things, you know, but present them, you know. Say them, meaning write good lyrics, but be able to present it as a singer-songwriter, mm-hmm. you know. So that became my focus, and it hasn't changed. It's still the most important thing for me, or I should say it's still where I'm really trying to develop myself further.
Well, I think those earlier records, I listened to them as guitar-based records.
Mm-hmm.
But the newer stuff, I know I can happily put on when driving and not worry about the guitar playing. I know I'm going to have some good songs, which is, you know,
nice.
A fantastic thing. Yeah. So, 3 records ago, Bringing It Back Home.
Mm-hmm.
That's for me when that what you and I would probably refer to as R&B influence really, as the title would suggest, came back.
Yeah.
But a lot of guys might think of that as a soul thing.
Mm-hmm.
Could you talk to us about some more of those influences? Some of the guitar players that readers might be able to check out.
Oh.
Where that influence came from.
For that record, Bringing It Back Home.
Yeah, and then what you're listening to now, really.
Well, I don't listen to guitar players.
Okay.
Just FYI, because
yep.
The reason being, and I think it's an important reason, something people should think about is, you know, you sound like who you listen to.
Yep.
So I listen to saxophone players, Miles Davis's trumpet, you
sure.
know, composers, you know, Indian music.
Right.
I'm big into Indian music.
Okay.
And I mean, that record is an interesting one. I mean, it is covers. There are only 2 original
yep.
pieces of music on that record, so it was rare for me,
yep.
you know, to do that, but it was intentional.
Hmm.
And one of the reasons was I didn't feel like writing songs.
Okay.
That's totally turned around since then,
yeah.
but at that time, it was just like, man, I've been working my butt off, you know, writing songs. I just didn't want to write. But I wanted to play, and I wanted to play a certain way. And that record, basically, it's, you know, the guitar is an Epiphone Riviera with one of those pickups right there.
Mini humbucker.
The mini humbucker.
Yeah.
I played the entire record on the rhythm pickup.
Right.
I think I use an overdrive once, and it's very subtle.
Mm.
You know, the notion was kind of like, I don't know if you know much about Lonnie Johnson.
I do, yeah.
It was kind of like Lonnie Johnson inspired, you know? Like, it never got loud, kind of stayed in one place, like the whole time, you know? It's always one volume, one pickup, one sound, and then it's just in the inflection where you get the variety, you know? So, I'm really happy with that record, the
it's
way it turned
record.
Out. Thank
Lovely
you.
Lovely record.
Thank you.
And As I say, for me, after that, it was a real, like there was a focus in your playing style,
mm-hmm.
The song side of things. A Day in Nashville next,
yeah.
And I feel that influence had stuck around a bit. What would you say to that?
You mean from the first record?
From
Bringing It Back
yes.
Home. A little bit. There was some attention to consistency. It had a lot to do with just the use of the trombone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I kind of wanted to stay in that sonic palette,
sure.
you know, but it's original music, you know, and I mean, I actually wrote 6 songs in 3 weeks because I had to,
yeah.
or I should say I wanted to, you know,
yeah.
I really did, because otherwise it would have been, you know, kind of a repetition of what I'd done. So, you know, the songwriting thing certainly came back. It's a lot broader. The influences are a lot broader in the Day in Nashville record.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just that kind of R&B thing, slightly New Orleans-y,
yeah.
you know. It's a little broader, a little more jazz in it. There's some rock in it, kind of, you know. So it's the new record, really, where for me things have really come full circle, you know,
yeah.
to where, I couldn't be happier with the new album, you know.
Yeah, and perfect point to lean on. So talk to us about the new album.
What would you like to know?
So the title is?
Oh, the title of the record is Into the Sun.
Yeah. And it has 11 tracks on, I believe. And
mm-hmm.
Some great, really, really great tunes on there. Highlight for me at the moment would probably be High Heels and Throwing Things.
Well, I appreciate your saying that. You know, for me, that's it's the most fun.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's tongue-in-cheek.
Mm.
You know, it's meant to have humor. And the drums and bass on it are just fantastic. You know, the groove those
yeah.
guys are laying down is just great.
Yeah.
And it's a very, you know, kind of unique and unusual lyric, certainly for me. I've not really written like that before.
Yeah.
But I really opened up the doors on... you know, the lyric writing for this record. I just kind of pushed the envelope a little bit, you know. And there's a young friend of mine, his name is Kyle Swan. He's a co-writer lyrically on the record.
Okay.
He contributed like the last verse to a couple of the songs. In both cases, last verse, for whatever the reasons, you know. I'd already basically written the song.
Hmm.
And he writes in a very abstract, kind of out there way. It's like hard to even know what he's saying half the time. And he wrote a song on the record that I recorded. It's entirely his, called Same Train.
Okay.
And he wrote all of the lyric, and I wrote the music to a song called Howling at the Moon.
Yeah.
And so anyway, that very open with the lyrics, you know. Not so worried about being super clear. And that is something that I have kind of... I've forced myself to do, is be clear,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the past. It's like, you have to really, really work at something if you're going to get good at it, you know. You need to push yourself, you know. And my wife comes out of a Broadway musical background. And so, you know, that's basically the Great American Songbook. It's Rodgers and Hammerstein,
yeah.
you know, and Kurt Weill and Bertolt Brecht and... yeah, Jerome Kern and Cole Porter,
yeah.
you know, so there's a lot of craft in this, in writing songs, you know. And so, you know, I was inspired by those people, and I read books by them, and I read lyrics by them, and, you know, I mean, you got to really put yourself into something, man, you know.
Yeah.
People are so lazy about the songwriting thing. It's just disgusting to me how people treat the craft of songwriting. It's a craft that you could be really good at.
Yeah.
If you try, you know, if you work at it, I think anybody could get good at something they worked hard at.
Sure. And there are a lot of guys out there that see the song as a vehicle for their guitar playing, but...
Yeah, or their guitar.
Yeah.
or their hair.
Yeah.